I want to let you know we're not just fiddling around on purpose. It is 10:30 now, but we're going to wait just a few more minutes, and maybe we'll see a few more of our friends before we get ready to start, too. If you want. Well, and you've got time to get settled, because you know I'm going to ramble on about announcements for a while.
You've got to have a
10-minute prelude. Okay, prelude first.
Thank you.
Funny thing about it is that, as you'll hear later, I was going to talk about how important the prelude is in my sermon. And then I almost forgot it. Welcome home. Welcome back. It is so good to see you, so good to be together again. But it's also important to look that direction and say, welcome home to the folks who are watching our worship service live streaming. It's the first time we've gone live instead of recorded, and the first time to be in the sanctuary, and we hope that the live streaming is working, that the sound is working. I have worked for hours to try to figure out how to do it, and I hope we've got it right, folks. If we mess it up for you at home, I'm so sorry. We'll get it. It'll be better next week. But we want to know that there are about 18 or 19 of us in the room right now, spaced out, keeping proper social distance, all wearing masks. I'm so proud of you. But there's 50 or 60 or 70 of us that are in the room worshiping through that laptop back there that's live streaming. And you are with us and you are part of us, and we're glad you're here. I do want to say to those who are watching at home by live streaming that the quality of the sound and the quality of the picture is not what it's going to be. We have bought a really neat camera that will enable us to zoom in and pan around and give you a much better quality experience, but the camera and the computer don't seem to want to find each other and talk to each other yet. I've spent hours and hours on that, so we're just doing it from the camera on my laptop today, and it's very limited. Hopefully next week you're going to see a much more professional production, but we are going to worship God together anyway. I also want to welcome you to Father's Day. I see several fathers in the room. We are so grateful to you. I want you to know that we are all grateful for all of the support and the encouragement and the attaboys and attagirls and all of the kindness and gentleness. We're also grateful for the firm hand and the instruction and guidance and correction that you gave us over the years. We're grateful, Dad. There's been some research done. Michelle asked me, what do you want for Father's Day? I don't know. I have nothing I need. I've got my two ladies at home. I have nothing I need. And we talked about that in the research that shows that Father's Day gets about a fourth of the spending of Mother's Day. That's about the way it should be. That's the way dads are. We don't need much but to be surrounded by our family. And so, Dad, we're grateful for you. We're all grateful for our fathers. We remember the ones who've gone before. We were talking earlier, a few of us in the foyer, about what we buried in the casket with our fathers who've gone on home. My dad was buried with a wrench. Jack was buried with pipes. We remember our dads, and so we want to say that right now. Normally in our announcement time, we would be talking about all of the other fun things that are going on in the church. We're not there yet. We're not ready for that. We're just getting started and taking baby steps. So I do want to let you know that the office still won't be open on a regular scheduled basis. Cindy comes and goes from time to time. But if she's here and people see that her car is here, you'd be surprised how many just strangers just come by looking for a little assistance of this kind or that kind. And that's a virus danger when she has to let people she doesn't even know in the door who may or may not have masks and all. So we're trying to keep the office low key. The phone, the office phone is still forwarded to my phone. And I still want to hear from you and call me. Encourage others to call me. You're not bothering me when you call me. If I don't answer right away, do leave a message so I know you called. I'll get back to you. But we're just trying to be safe. The food pantry is going, and going very well. It's a drive-through food pantry. We have a major abundance of food right now in the food pantry, which is a blessing. And I ask you to pray for that, because as the town finds us, we're going to get busier and busier. But it's being done very, very carefully and safely. The whole system has been redesigned from the federal government on down, so it's safe for the pandemic. I want to thank our music team. Virginia's pulled together George and Jan to help us along with Bob, and they've agreed to play even though they should be at home. and sing for us. But I also want to remind you that we will not sing. We, the congregation, will not sing. They will sing four songs, I think, altogether to us. We're going to listen, and they're way back here, 30, 40 feet away from you, so that you should be safe. But what we know is that even with a mask on, singing puts out a lot of moisture, a lot of potential virus into the air. And so the recommendation is that congregations should not be singing. That's like 10 times more risk of putting a virus out into the air. So we're going to listen, sing along in your heart to the music, and there'll be a limited amount of music. We'll also not do communion because we'd have to remove our masks to do that. We have a system to do communion safely when we do get started, but we don't think we're ready for that quite yet. So this is a kind of a historic thing, a Disciples of Christ Church that doesn't do communion on Sunday. That's probably never happened in this church, ever. However, it seems like the thing we should do right now. I want you to be assured that the regular commitment to communion every Sunday is not wavering. It's just not time yet. We will get back to regular every week Sunday communion. That's an important part of our tradition of Christianity, and we're not going to give that up. So, any other announcements that I'm not thinking of that we should mention? There you go.
And he also asked who our cousin was. I told him you. He is also a cousin.
Okay. Thought I recognized the name.
Yeah,
okay. Okay. If there are no other announcements, obviously it would not be a good thing for us to walk around and greet one another in the Lord, but turn around and wave, because it's the first time we've seen one another's faces, or at least our eyes. How good it is to at least be in one another's presence again. And with that in mind, we're going to let Terry lead us in our call to worship and opening prayer.
Call to worship is going to be a bit different also, because I'm going to lead us and I'm going to answer us, and I'm coming on with gather us in, the brokenhearted and the joyful. Gather us in, the weak and the strong. Gather us in, the fearful and the brave. Gather us in to sing of God's works. Gather us in to praise Jesus Christ. Gather us in to worship and wonder. Gather us in to know of God's love. Let us bow our heads and pray unto the Lord. Holy God, bowed before you in humble adoration, we come to worship and to praise your holy name. May the glory and honor be to thee forever. We thank you, God, for hearing our prayers. We thank you, God, for all our blessings and being able to come together for this worship service. Some hesitantly, some scared or unsure. But Lord, with one voice as in one body, and the one heartfelt desire is to be here praising and worshiping you, our God and Heavenly Father, who through the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus, whose death, burial, and resurrection gracefully becomes our redemptive Savior. For you say, whoever has faith to believe and call his name shall be saved. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for calling us. Bless Pastor Steve as he delivers your word for us. Open our ears and our hearts to receive it. It's in Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Have been gathered together from quite a scattered situation, and we're grateful that we can come to the Lord together in prayer, praying here, praying in our homes. I want to lift up Jackie, who is continuing her battle with cancer, not able to do chemotherapy, still in discussions with her doctors about radiation, but from time to time in some real weakness and pain now. Jackie's on quite a battle, and we want to pray for her. Monica had a friend who was in a car accident that I haven't heard the latest, was taken to Methodist Hospital. Has anyone heard from Monica about her friend? Rear-ended a semi. And I'm going to be very awkward about this one. I apologize. Maybe someone can help me remember who I'm talking about. I received a call from Kathleen Myers in South Carolina. Her sister here in Anderson passed away, and their family were raised in this church. Her sister was in a group home, had some mental handicaps for much of her life, was in a group home, and matter of fact, her parents helped start what became Hopewell, and they were members of our church here, and she died in a care facility. She was 70, her sister was. Kathleen and Dan are the surviving siblings. Does that ring any bells about who I'm talking about? Bud, I think, might have been the father's name. I've got it written down, and it's at home, because we're going to do a simple graveside service this week, this coming week. Well, shoot. Since I have it written down at home and I'm forgetting the important name here, it will go around in a prayer chain. But we want to pray for that family. It's a family, an old historic family in this church that were born and raised and married here. So we will pray for them. Other prayer requests? Yeah. Okay, Roxanne is having a very significant eye surgery on Thursday, and Denise is having cataract surgery, which is usually more routine, but still, we want to pray for her. And when you get a chance, thank Denise for all the work she does, and especially in this time where she's worked the phone so hard to keep us connected. Let us pray together. Holy God, in the middle of a world that gives us so much to worry about, we come to you today in gratitude. We're so grateful that you've led us through this time and that you've gathered us back together in this room, in the light and the smell and the beauty of this place. We're so grateful that in all this time, we're all safe, we're all well, or nearly so. We're grateful for your protecting hand. We're grateful that you have inspired us to be obedient and to be careful and to be sensible in our behavior and take proper precautions. That you've taught us how important it is to protect each other through the precautions we take. We're grateful for those who are here, and we're grateful for those who made the decision to stay home. We trust that was the wise decision, but we also trust that they are here with us in spirit. And so we pray and we love one another in the flesh and in the internet. We're also grateful, dear God, for our fathers, for the role of fatherhood, which is so important. We're grateful for the fathers we had. We're grateful for the other folks that stepped up and were like fathers to us, when we didn't always get everything we needed from our biological fathers. We're grateful for those who couldn't be fathers, can't be fathers, and who are missing their fathers, because we know that there have always been folks who would step up and be a mentor and a role model and a father figure. And so, God, we ask that you would continue to be our divine father, a kind father, a gentle father, but a guiding father, who will show us the way and show us the way home. Continue to show us the way through the strange era in which we are living in every way, the virus, the politics, the violence in our streets, all of it. Dear God, be a wise father. Be the one who knows the path and keeps us on the path and doesn't let us stray. Hold us together against forces that would pull us apart. And hold us in your arms as you carry us home to the kingdom you promised. Heal those who are sick, including those who are sick with grief and with anxiety about the future. Put your protective hand over so many of our congregation who, for different reasons of age or illness, are vulnerable right now. Give us wisdom. Calm our spirits when it seems like every force in the world wants to get us agitated and upset. Calm our spirits. Fill us with the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding. And guide us and strengthen us for the coming week as we continue to pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
Thank you.
you want to cry. Today's scripture is from the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, verses 19 through 25. Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through the flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching, which is the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you.
We're going to sing for you now, Blessed Assurance.
You may have noticed I was taking your picture. That's because we don't have attendance registers, but it's even more important that we know who was here so that if we needed to, we could do contact tracing and contact you to let you know if there was any problems. I feel like I'm on an alien spaceship. I mean, you ought to see it from this point of view. All of these people in masks, like aliens that have no noses and no mouths, just eyes, you know? It's like a Doctor Who episode on the BBC. Call us the Druid. It's very strange. It's not comfortable. We need to acknowledge that we did not get to come back together in worship for a big, massive Easter celebration where we could see everyone's smiling faces like we said we were going to when this all started. We came back in a very strange and awkward situation. Frankly, I'm thrilled, first of all, that you're practicing the good, safe guidelines this morning. I'm also glad that nobody hyperventilated and fainted singing up here, because it is a trick to sing inside of a mask. And it's also a trick to preach from inside of a mask, I have to tell you. We miss the hugs and the handshakes and the smiles, but this is what we must do right now. Still, we celebrate that we have been gathered together again. We've been regathered together to worship God in this sacred space. And I thought that the appropriate sermon series to get started with would be called The Heart of Worship. There was a church which faced a very different circumstance than ours. They had a big elaborate praise team, but they were arguing about music. Now, I have to explain to you that some churches have been known to have conflicts about music. That may have never happened here. But some churches have, people have griped about the selection of songs that are too loud or too soft or too fast or too slow or too modern or too traditional or whatever. And this church was frankly being torn apart by disagreements and arguments about the music in the congregation. And so the pastor, the senior pastor, and the elders decided that we're forgetting what worship is all about. And so they stopped doing any music for 3 months. They said, this is ridiculous. No music at all. They didn't fire the people they paid to do music. They just said, we're taking a 3-month sabbatical to think about what church is really supposed to be about. And so for 3 months, they worshiped without a single note of music being raised in the sanctuary. They opened the Word of God, and they prayed, and they studied. And when that 3 months was over, and the music team got back together to provide music again for that first worship service, their worship leader, who's a famous church musician named Michael W. Smith, wrote a song, and they started out singing a song in which the chorus says, I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry for the thing I've made it when it's all about you. And that was the first notes, the first song, when that congregation came back together to remember why they were really worshiping. But we're not in that kind of conflict situation, but we have been scattered apart for a while. And so it is good for us to consider, what does it really mean to worship God as we restart worship together? Why do we even bother to worship God? It may surprise you to learn that there was a time, even in my ministry, when I actually raised that question seriously. I mean, it began to occur to me that God is not so vain or insecure or egotistical that God needs us to gather together and praise and flatter God. God is perfectly fine if we don't worship. We are the ones who need to worship. And that's why our scripture today says, among other things, do not neglect to gather yourselves together in worship. Whether, by the way, in this building, or don't neglect to sit down at home and actually worship with us here in this sanctuary. God is tangibly present to us when we worship, and we need to be in the presence of God. Worship shapes us and forms us. Many of you have told me that worship is that part of your week which flavors the entire week. That's what we need. Worship is sometimes called, in a Latin word, liturgy. It's the work of the people, which means I want to tell you, as we consider what it is to worship, just at its fundamental core concept, what does it mean to worship? Worship is not a spectator sport. Kyle Eidelman says, Jesus doesn't need fans who sit in the stands and cheer. Jesus needs people that will get in the game. We need to be fully committed participants in the kingdom of God. fully committed participants in worship. Let me ask you a question for example. As Terry led us in prayer and call to worship, and then I led us in prayer to call to worship, were you watching us do that? Or were you really praying yourself? It just takes an internal shift in perspective to be conscious that I'm working at worshiping right now. Worship is not an hour on Sunday either. Worship is a lifestyle. What we do on Sunday is just one part of how the whole week structures. It sort of revolves around this hour of worship. Worship began with the Jewish Sabbath, and the Jewish Sabbath was not just one day of the week in which they rested and devoted to God. It was not just the last day of the week, it was the first full day of Adam and Eve's life. You notice that God created Adam and Eve on Friday. It wasn't until close to evening before the process of creating them and working out things was fully done. And the first thing God gave them was a day off. They'd never worked a day in their life. But the rest and the sacredness of the Sabbath was the first thing they did to remind them and us that we weren't created to work. We were created to live. And so in other times in history, worship has been not just an hour on Sunday, but a constant part of the flow of our lives. In a medieval village in Europe, the church bells, the reason church bells were invented was to call the whole village to worship several times a day. The church bells would ring at 6 a.m. for a brief worship service, 15 or 20 minutes of morning prayers. And at 9 a.m., the bells would ring, and the village would flock to the village church for another little 15 or 20 minutes of worship. Maybe not everybody could get there. Some of the farmers are out in the fields. They would stop that mule, lean up on that plow for a few minutes, and pray when they heard the church bells ringing in the distance. And then at noon, and at 3 o'clock, and at 6 o'clock, and even at 9 o'clock at night, in their homes, as they were just getting ready to fall into bed, the church bells called the whole village to stop what they were doing and worship. This may be part of what Paul meant when he advised us to pray without ceasing. That worship is a way of approaching life. I got a little experience of that when I shared morning prayers and then breakfast with Archbishop Tutu. Michelle and I, because of some work we'd done on his children's Bible, were invited to his hotel room in San Francisco as he was passing through. And we joined Father Tutu and his wife Leah and his daughter Empo and his son-in-law and personal assistant, Muthunzi. And I remember when Muthunzi came down to the lobby to get us and bring us up to Father Tutu's hotel room, he said, "I'm so glad you're here." He was just a very natural, open guy. He said, "Every single morning, Father Tutu insists on doing a complete hour-long Anglican worship service with all the recitations and readings and chants. And if it's only him and me, I have to do half of it." So he said, "I'm so glad you're here. It's so much better when there's folks to share it with." And we did. We spent an hour together through the whole Anglican worship, broke the bread, drank the wine, and shared communion with him, and then went to breakfast. Every morning of his life, he spends an hour in worship. And he will tell you, he told me, "I could not have done any of the things I did in the world that earned a Nobel Peace Prize, that helped end apartheid and bring racial equality to South Africa, without that morning of worship to center me and to keep me centered in the things of God." So worship is a whole way of life for Christians, not just an hour on Sunday or some other day. But now let's talk today's subject, really. And today's scripture talks about the beginning of worship, how we gather together to worship. We've been regathered together. So I wanted to talk about gathering. Beginnings are important. We don't just worship. We don't just kind of ooze into the room and the worship starts. We are gathered and we're called by God into a state of worship. Getting some feedback here, Kenny. Getting some feedback, I think. I want you to consider what it means to understand that you are not here by accident, that God called you to be here today, that there's some reason in God's great plan why you had to be here today. And friends at home, God called you to be in the chair you're at home, participating in worship with us. God called us to be in this hour together. And how that call happens varies from place to place. In the Muslim world, there's a person called a muezzin who sings the calls to worship at different hours of the day from a tower in an Arab city. It's a very beautiful and ethereal kind of a music that calls the whole city to stop and pray. The church bells we talked about were invented for this purpose. Terry led us in a call to worship earlier. But it's important that that not become a mere formality, but that that call to worship is a deliberate interruption of the mundane everyday life we live, that it stops us in our tracks, and that we say in our own hearts, I'm shifting gears now. I'm in a state of worship and an attitude of worship. The call to worship is really when worship begins. Things change. We enter into a new reality when we participate in the call to worship. Although in another sense, worship really begins as we start to gather together. You know that worship really begins as you pull into the parking lot, that you start getting your mind ready, your heart begins to move into another place as you walk from the parking lot into the building. There are a bunch of scriptures which tell us about how they worshiped in Israel in the old days. Come up and let us go up to the house of the Lord, it says in Isaiah chapter 2. That was a call to worship. And it says, let us go up to the house of the Lord. In Psalm 122, it says, I was glad when they said to me, let us go up to the house of the Lord. Psalm 24, who shall ascend the hill of God? And who shall stand in his holy place? These are all calls to worship that were used in formal liturgy and formal worship in the Jewish world of the time of the temple. See, the temple was on top of a hill. And the folks would gather down at the bottom of that hill. And the priests would call them to worship. And they would process up the hill. Psalm 68 describes it. And we see that the singers come first. Well, the priests come first. And then the singers and the musicians come last. And in between are girls dancing with tambourines. And the whole crowd follows singing. And they march. They process like a parade up that hill and through the gates into the temple. Scripture says, make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. You see, the walk into the building is a part of the act of worship, part of the call to worship. I was telling someone the other day about a funeral in the black African-American tradition, church tradition. It was a very big funeral for a minister who passed away. He'd been very active in his town, very active in our denomination, not just locally, but nationally. And it had been his dying wish that lots of clergy would come and that we would all wear our robes and stoles. And so there were 30 or 40 ministers, Disciples of Christ ministers, and ministers from all over the city that were not Disciples of Christ. And we gathered in another room, and in the African-American tradition, there would be a procession, much like going up the hill and into through the gates of the temple with all the ministers in their robes. The bad part is that somebody who was organizing this mistook me for someone else or something, put me near the front of the procession, which meant that as we came up, I just got marched, that was against my will, up on the platform to sit with 15 or 20 clergy on the platform who were all going to speak. All going to speak, except for me. I didn't have anything to say. So I had to sit there for 2.5 hour funeral service and not fidget. It was not easy. So you want to be in the right spot in the procession, particularly if you don't have to speak. I felt real embarrassed about that. I know that somebody was thinking, what's that guy up there for? But I just kind of got put in the wrong spot. There's a procession. It was a grand procession, though. It was a beautiful thing to see. How we begin is important. We are now entering into the gates of heaven. That's what the call to worship is telling us. And by the way, that means that when we do the call to worship, when Terry led us in that call to worship, in that moment, we stopped being in Anderson, Indiana. We stopped being in the United States of America. That's why the flag for the country we do love is out there. It's not in a sanctuary. Because in here, we're in the throne room of God. It's not the territory of any nation. We're in heaven. We're in heaven when the call to worship is done. We're in the presence of God. My Greek and Russian Orthodox friends believe that time literally stops during their worship service. That's why they can worship for a couple of hours and not get tired. We're no longer in the year 2020. Time collapses so that when we come to this table, we're eating with Adam and Eve and God in the cool of the evening in Eden. And we're eating with David and the priests in the temple in Jerusalem. And we're eating with Jesus and the disciples in the upper room. And we're eating that great feast that's yet to come in the kingdom of heaven. Past, present, and future all collapse into one thing. And we are with all of those saints from all of those different times, sharing the same bread and the same wine. Doesn't matter if you're at home, by the way, or in the sanctuary. The truth is that we are all in the same place. We're in the throne room of God, before the presence of God. Sacred space, a sacred moment. And if we come into worship with that attitude, with that commitment, then our feeling shifts, our behavior shifts, things open up in our minds and hearts in ways that would not open up if we treated this like it's just another meeting, like a sales meeting or a business meeting or a committee. Before I quit, I want to remind you that worship is an everyday thing. How do you worship at home? I hope you worship at home. How do your mornings begin? What's your morning routine? And does that lead you into an hour of worship, into a time at least of worship? Do you use music or do you use silence to lead you into worship at home? Do you read a scripture or a devotional book? Maybe it's your style to take a walk, and that's okay. You could imagine yourself walking up the hill and entering into the temple of Jerusalem as you walk with the Lord, as your form of worship. Some people have a special place in their home devoted to worship. Jesus talked about entering into your closet to worship in private. My friend Mike Bever always took that kind of seriously, and he had a house that worked for that. So he had a closet that he had set aside in the hallway just for worship. He would go into that closet, and he said, when I pulled that light chain in the closet and sat down in that chair that I kept in the closet for that purpose and closed the door, then I was in the presence of God. Beginnings matter. And how we begin again to worship again in this holy place matters. The decision we make about what it means that we're here today really matters. Did we enter this room? Are we sitting in this room right now as a sacred space, a sacred hour where time stops? And we're no longer in Indiana. And do we live our entire lives so that this hour is the heart of it all, the heart of the whole week? Do we still our minds, steady our thoughts on Jesus? And do we do the same thing if we're doing it at home? Do you understand, brothers and sisters who are seeing us from your home, that you are in the room with us? But the room I'm talking about is not on 53rd Street. It's in the throne, before the throne of God. And we stand shoulder to shoulder there, right now. Our God calls us to a lifestyle of worship. And he doesn't do so because God needs our worship, but because we need to worship. Whether you're in this room or at home watching, let us enter into worship deliberately. And be touched by the presence of God. Because what worship ultimately reminds us of is that God is God. And we are not God. And you and I don't have to be God. Like someone says on the refrigerator, has a little note from God, says, "Why don't you stop worrying about it? I've got it covered." Going to sing one verse of that one, Virginia tells us. Just for my own sake, I want to find out. I just want to take a little survey. Am I the only one that kept forgetting not to sing? Did you find yourself singing in spite of the fact that we had said we weren't going to? Yeah. We will all just apologize to one another. It's hard not to with these beautiful old hymns. It really is. And I am grateful to God that you're still on your feet, Virginia, trying to breathe through the mask and sing, and George and Jan. I want to mention the offering. We are back in church now, so we actually do have an offering. We will not have deacons passing the plates back and forth, but they're right back there. As you leave, if you would, do remember that everything is God's, and return your portion to God in gratitude and in love for the God who's loved us so much, and just drop those in the place, and God says thank you. I also want to invite us as we depart to this is almost the hardest thing of all I've had to ask you to do. Try to limit how long we linger and chat out there in the foyer, and get ourselves moved on out to the cars fairly quickly. I know it's nearly impossible for us not to say hello and I love you to church members that we love so much. But the longer we stand there and breathe closer to each other, the more risk there is. So we hope that we will move on out to our cars and go home grateful for the time we did have together without putting one another at any greater risk. So say hello, wave from a distance, and may God give you a great and a blessed Father's Day and first day of summer. And now go in peace, assured that nothing separates us from the love of God or from the presence of God. Therefore, every table at which you sit this week will be God's table. So boldly pray, hold fast to hope, encourage and provoke love into action. Amen. And obviously, I'm not going to stand at the back and shake hands. I'm going to stand here and wait. God bless you.